Going on, everyone. Welcome to episode 4 of the INXOF podcast. We're talking all things Christian living, navigating this world, being a Christian, and also, how to be in the world, not of it. INXOF. You get it. Fellas, how are you? Good to see you. Did you guys see the new trailer for Love and Thunder?
Yes, I indeed did. Yeah. Actually, on that note, news article that a guy in Florida has seen the new Spider-Man film like 270 times.
I did see that. The dude's so
if someone has seen it 270 times, our viewers should have at least seen it once.
Yeah, he saw the movie. Really? This guy, it was classic because it said Florida Man. I was like, I'm interested.
Yeah.
Florida Man sees the new Spider-Man movie 273 times, whatever it was. Setting a new world record.
Is there a movie that you've kind of watched a lot? I'm not saying 273 times. Was it, if you could think of the top of your head, maybe you're just like, I've seen that so many times.
Hot Rod.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, I feel like I've watched that movie.
Love Hot Rod.
That's so funny.
That's a good movie.
Yeah.
I think like the Steve Jobs, Michael Fassbender, Steve Jobs film. I've seen that a dozen times.
Really?
Just love it.
Really?
I never saw it. I've only seen Ashton Kutcher's.
Oh, mate,
Jobs.
Ashton Kutcher can't hold a candle up to
steady on, mate. Steady on. Don't come after Ashton.
Done know nothing, mate.
Right.
Wow. So. Okay. Well, there we go. That's good.
Yeah. What about you, Lance? Your question?
Inception. I think I've seen Inception.
Really?
Yeah.
Have you figured it out yet?
Is that why you keep watching it?
I just keep watching it because I can't figure it out.
Yeah.
So, I think that's definitely one.
I think it's about dreams. Yeah. I think I've watched it 17 times and we're getting dreams.
I'll watch it again tonight and I'll let you know, boys.
Yeah, see what you can work out.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah, so. That's awesome. Yeah.
Cool. And then there's an Australian classic called The Castle that I think I watched. That's my comfort movie. Like if I was having like a rough time overseas, because when I was in the States, I would just remind me of home. Today we're talking about sort of continuing the theme of sharing your stories, your testimony, that three-parter before meeting and then because of Jesus, that kind of thing. We heard in episode 2, Marcus's story, so you can go a little bit of your story.
Yeah.
And so, Lance, we're excited to hear more of your story today. We can get into that. We've got a few more things we want to talk about, but we'll see where we go. This conversation's a river. We'll just see where it leads us. Hopefully, to
Lance's
story. To somewhere interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I grew up in New Zealand. I was born in New Zealand, in Auckland.
Right.
Born in 1993.
Oh, wow, great.
Yeah, so I lived there for about 16 years, and then we moved here to Australia, 2010. So I've been here about 12 years now. Does that make sense? I'm counting that right. So yeah, then and I guess my journey from there and to here, it's been a big one.
Of course.
Went to coming to know Jesus. My mum always kind of went to church when we were younger. So mum was the one that was kind of dragged us along to church, and we always kind of went with her in that sense. So I can say I kind of grew up in a Christian home, being around with mum. So heading there, it wasn't probably until I hit my teens. Starting to get to the really like, who is this Jesus? Who is God? So I really started to ask those questions in my teens. Right. And that's it. But also I started to kind of rebel or make a lot of mistakes in my teens. So I was also that constant pull of trying to be in church, but also I just wanted to do my own thing. So I was really kind of like, is he real? Nah, I'll just do whatever I want. Then I really hit a really big point in my life. I lost my granddad just before I started kind of high school, and so that really started to resonate with me. I was like, well, you know, he's gone now. He was kind of like a spiritual figure to me, so I was like, where to in my life now? Like, he was someone who, I don't know, he was just a figure in our life. He was just so faithful, and he would pray with us, pray for us, and it was kind of a shock when he passed away. So then I started having those thoughts of like, well, there's got to be more to life than this. Wonder what it is. So I kind of seeking like, well, what's my purpose in life? I think that was a big question I wanted to kind of
and
ask
what
myself.
Age were you then? That was before high school.
Yeah, like, so I was about 12.
Wow,
years.
Okay.
So that pinnacle of like, I'm
totally
just heading into, and then, you know, you kind of start high school, and that's where you, that first year, you kind of want to be the cool kid.
Yeah, so totally. Oh my gosh.
Assert dominance when you're grade 7 or year 9 if you're in New Zealand, you're trying to assert that dominance. So yeah, I got really lost there coming into that first few years of high school because I didn't know who I was. I was really like just, I was trying to be the class clown. I was trying to be funny. I was trying to just make sense or make purpose of my life. And then got really bad until I was about 16. And then, really, I struggled with my identity. So I didn't really know who I was. I was trying to fit in with everybody and trying to be friends with everybody. It just wasn't working. And then, had a real big revelation. Had a it's a big point in my life where someone just asked me, I was like, dude, do you know Jesus? You know of Jesus, but do you know Jesus?
Like somebody asked you, just point blank.
Like,
yeah, wow.
Yeah, and I was like, oh, because I see you go to church, I see you all this, but...
Because you were going to church all the while?
All the while, yeah. I was still going to youth group.
Still
with my friends, like Christian friends, but then I would have all the other people who would just party and do whatever. So someone actually sat down with me. I was like, well, hey, you know of Jesus, but do you actually know Jesus? And I was like, I know that he died for us. I was like, yeah, everyone knows that, but
everyone knows. It's sort of like almost like, oh, everyone knows that that's what Christians believe.
Yes,
yeah.
You've heard the story. You've been to church for how many years now? But
right.
Do you actually know him personally? And then I was like, oh, what do you mean? As well, you know, have you said this prayer that you know, invite him into your heart? I was like, oh, really? So he led me through that moment, and then that kind of shifted. I was like, whoa! Like in that moment, he led me through the prayer. You know, like, just accept Jesus into your life, and that shifted. And I was like, oh, whoa! Like. Jesus is the real deal. I was like, oh my gosh, he's my savior. Oh my, I want to know more about him. And I kind of just went head first, like back in church. Not going to do any of that stuff.
Wow.
Head first. Yeah, straight into serving youth group and blah, blah, blah. And then kind of hit a moment where you kind of don't want to hear as you're kind of coming in to be like a youth leader. And someone actually said to me, they were like, a few years being in church, they were like, I don't think you're cut out to be a leader. And I was okay. So then I was like, well, why am I doing it? So again,
because you're trying to be a youth, you were trying to be a youth leader, like, and then someone's like, this isn't for you,
I was
probably.
Like serving in church and serving in youth, and I was kind of just doing, I thought, oh, this is really great. This is the, oh my gosh, this is the life I want to live. And then someone actually pulled me aside, and I was remembering, I was seeing a lot of people to start getting more opportunities, and I was like, oh, I'd love to try that. And then they said, oh, actually, we don't think you're cut out for it. And I went, oh, okay. And I was like, okay. Sweet. So that was like big moment. Oh my gosh, I love Jesus. This is the best life. Bam. I don't think you're.
Because when did that happen? Like that prayer was happening.
About 17.
Yeah. Did you say you were 16 about when you like 16 did that prayer?
So about a year and then 17 that kind of hit. And then
wow.
And then that's when I kind of sprouted. I was like, oh yeah, whatever. We actually moved here just before I turned 17. So I was probably about 16, still 16, hitting 17. That's when we moved here. And so I was like, cool, I just want to find a new identity again.
Wow.
Moving here and try to go with that. And then, probably 3 more years of just nothing in my life, just trying to discover my purpose. Big void in my heart that I wanted to fill. Walked into Hope Center. Parents found Hope Center when they came here.
Okay.
Oh, City Church it was called. And they were going to church. Always invited me, always praying for me. No, I just never wanted to go. And then they invited me one Sunday to come along. And I said, yeah, well, why not? Like this, what's the worst that could happen? I guess I can go back to church. The parents invited me, and I remember Pastor Josh was preaching, and he actually was preaching. It's like, you know, God wants to take this. Like I literally remember clear as day, just saying, that God actually wants to take this burden from you. Like you can actually lay this burden down. And I was just sobbing in there.
Wow. Because you felt like your burden was.
I just wasn't good enough. Or like, oh, okay, sweet, like whatever.
Because did you feel like that's such an interesting thing for someone to say to you? I feel like, did you feel that conversation to me would have felt like they were telling me that I'm not cut out for Christian to be a Christian?
Yeah, I was just, it was like demoralizing more than anything. Like I was just like, oh well, like and I was like, well, what am I doing then? Like if I'm like, I kind of sit back and be like, well, what am I doing serving this church then?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I can sleep in on Sunday then. Like,
yeah.
What are you talking about? So I was
like, yeah, that's the thing. I was like, they didn't appreciate what you were doing by telling you that they didn't think you were cut out for it. That's really.
Yeah.
Do you know what was happening there? Like what their thinking
actually,
was?
I went back probably about a few years ago. I went back to kind of ask because I like they're prominent figures in my life who they were. So I went and asked, and they just said, we just thought you weren't cut out for it. I went, oh, okay, like that's fair for them. Like, there's actually no malice, but intent. Like, that's what they thought. So I was like, cool, maybe they were protecting me from something that I didn't know or didn't see. So, so I just went, oh yeah, whatever then. So,
okay, Yeah, that's really cool that you're able to look at it with grace and understand their perspective of it. But we don't know what the Holy Spirit might have been whispering to them or what could have been going on in their hearts that they're protecting you from. So that's super interesting. But so you were able to sort of...
Yeah, so again, so I was like in the wilderness after my granddad died. Oh my gosh, Jesus is amazing. Oh, I don't think you're cut out for this. Back in the wilderness again. Mm. And then find myself at Hope Center. We were at the trade college and Pastor Josh was preaching and I responded to the message. I was like, yeah, I just need to come back home.
Wow.
That was early 2013. And then the next week he came up to me and he asked me a question that seriously just changed the course of my life now. He was like, would you like to be a youth leader?
Wow.
I was like, sure.
Wow.
Why not?
Delivered that opportunity to you again.
Yeah. And then he came up and he was like, would you like to be a youth leader? And I was like, sure. So I became a youth leader on his team. And then throughout the year, I just saw God shift things in my life, move things and reveal things to me. And then by the end of the year, he was like, yeah, you're going to be a youth pastor. So, and then he was like, then you should do Bible college. And I was like, oh, okay. So then 2014, I've been the youth pastor since. So, and that kind of leads to today in this moment. So
that's great.
About a
7-8 year
journey.
Seeing how God sort of redeems these things that take us out of, like, it was someone saying that you weren't cut out to be a youth leader, and then almost that which got you back in was an invitation to be a youth leader.
Yeah,
like, of course, that was that message from laying down your burden and you were understanding your relationship and your position with Christ first, and then and then the opportunity to be a youth leader, like, you know, you have value and you give value in the house. That's really cool.
Yeah. And I I lost my job because I just stopped going to work. Okay. This is so weird. After becoming a youth leader, I just stopped going to work.
What were you working?
I was working at the... they probably listened to the podcast. I was working at the Royal of Brisbane. I was just I was a kitchen hand. I wasn't like a nurse or anything or doctor. I was working there and then I was working casual and I wanted to do more stuff for youth and I had all the stuff I just wanted to do didn't have time. So I just stopped going to work.
Don't recommend. That's terrible.
If you're rostered on, then just go to work.
Just show up to work, man. Show up 15 minutes early with your shoes on.
Absolutely. And leave 15 minutes afterwards. Exactly. Show that you're a good worker. Have a good work ethic. But I was like, because I was just so engrossed and like, oh my gosh, like I'm in, this is what I want to do.
Man. I love that. Having the passion for, the passion for like what you're doing and where God's put you. That's really awesome. Yeah.
And I literally got fired because they were called and was like, yeah, we're not gonna just tell me straight, are you gonna come back to work? And I was like, no, probably not. And they were like, okay, cool, whatever, it's done. So I went to the prayer meeting that night and I was I have no job, I got no money, I'm just doing youth here, and I'm sitting there and I'm like, God, okay, where do I go to from here? And then Pastor Josh again called me out of the prayer meeting and just said, mate, you need to do Bible college. And I was like,
wow,
with no money, just got fired, and I was like, sure, let's go.
Wow.
So I did it, and that was the end of 2013, and then I did Hope Academy in 2014. So
that's so unreal, dude.
Wow.
Yeah, that's crazy. Yeah, that's so funny. The job, that's hilarious. Yeah, I remember straight after high school, I started working at Macca's, and I was so late to my first shift that they called me and just said, don't come in.
Oh, what?
I was so...
Come on, mate.
They were like, the person who's training you has to leave in like an hour. So you... No, just don't come in. I caught the wrong bus. Or I caught...
That's a nightmare.
I caught the outbound bus 4 times. Four different buses outbound instead of... Because it's the same number.
Yes.
Yeah. Outbound and inbound. I caught the outbound bus 4 times.
That's a nightmare. That's a nightmare.
That was an absolute nightmare. And I was like, I'm never going to get a job ever because I've been looking for a long time. Yeah. And then the second shift, the same job. So that was like the Monday, I think. And then the Wednesday, I was supposed to have another shift, but I had to call up and say I couldn't come to that shift because there was an event on at school that I had to be at.
Right.
And so I called them and I was like, hey... So, I've got that shift on Wednesday. I can't make it. And she said basically the same thing. She was like, we just hired you do you want this job? Like, do you want to work here? I was like, yes, I do, please.
Do you want to work here?
Yeah, yeah. She's like, because I can't be chasing you. I like, you know, this whole thing. And I was like, yikes, that's like, the worst.
Third time lucky?
Yeah. Okay. I nailed it. Nailed the third one. You'd be happy.
And you were 15 minutes on time.
Exactly.
Yep, absolutely. Yep.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely.
15 minutes early, stayed 15 minutes late.
Yep.
Mopped the manager's office floor or whatever. I didn't do that, but made an extra cheeseburger. I don't know.
I'm proud that, I'm glad that you missed the bus, because at first I thought you just didn't show up on time because you were like, oh yeah, I'll get there when I get there.
Yeah.
But the fact, missed the bus, it's horrible.
Yeah, that's it's very painful. Yeah, that was tough. There was one other time when I was a kid, I had another job that I just didn't go to one afternoon. Like, I just forgot. And it was like 5 o'clock and I was like, oh, and I remember that I had work and I just, and that boss was really mean. And I was like, oh no, I just had
that
to call.
Sinking,
like,
feeling. Yeah. Horrible.
Yeah. It's just like, and you're like, oh, I know I've messed up and I know like the tough conversation I have to have.
Yeah. Yeah,
And it's always better to have the conversation than like wait until they follow you up.
Yeah.
Obviously, because like the conflict deferred, it only gets worse. But still, you're like, I don't want to have to make this call.
Yeah.
Hey, because they know I'm not there. I can't be like, hey, I'm not there. And they're like, oh, you're not. You know what I mean? Like, they definitely knew.
Mm.
But yeah, that was tough. Tough times.
It's interesting you mentioned that you had those kind of 3 years that you had drifted away, but you kept getting invited and parents are still praying for you and stuff. I know I've got mates and stuff who have drifted away, and I'm 50-50 about inviting them to church because I'm like, they get the Jesus thing and they're not interested, so why should I keep inviting them? So I guess I'm curious, like, if you can reflect back on that, like, can you remember times when the fact that people were inviting you that had an impact on you, of like, I'm still welcome here, or like, where you were thinking when they would invite you and you'd say no, like your thought process behind that?
Yeah.
It's a very good question.
Yeah, I think also never underestimate like praying parents.
Yeah.
I used to hear them just like pray for me through like the walls at home and stuff. So I'm always grateful for my parents who prayed for me. But every time they invited me, it was always like a warm invitation. And when anyone invited me, like, it was kind of like I knew I needed to go back, but I was just being stubborn and just didn't want to.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, oh.
So the persistence of invitation was a good thing.
And it was, and every time they asked, it wasn't like you're coming with me to church. They were like, hey son, would you like to come to church today? And sometimes I would answer and sometimes I won't. And you know, they would say, hey, we're gonna leave at 8:15 if you want to come. Just make sure you get up and get ready. Hey, we're gonna have breakfast. You know, it was always like just like really warm invitations. And I didn't feel any like wasn't mad or anything that were inviting me. I just never thought, like I said, like you mentioned, I just never thought I could go back, or it was like, it would take a lot for me to come there. Like,
I feel like I understand what you're saying, in that sometimes you feel like you're inviting a friend and you don't want to bug them because like they were at church, they were, you know, they were in the whole world. And then they sort of moved away from it, and so they know what it's all about and they're not interested.
Yeah.
So I'll just leave them alone.
Yeah.
But you're saying that you should, like, persisting in inviting, because
you've
been that person.
I was interested and then I was out, and then I was almost like, I've been there, and I had every right to kind of say no, because I was like, I've done this before, why would you?
To ask it almost more directly is like, what did you need from your friends in those times that you were away, those 3 times where you were like totally absent doing your own thing, to feel like you were always welcome back at church?
Yeah, it was almost like they didn't care. It was almost like they didn't care what I'm doing or what I've done, but they care enough that they don't want it to happen again. So they were like, that's why they just persist in just inviting. Just like, but it was such, like I said, they were so gracious, and it just wasn't like oh, look at you again, huh? Guess you should. Have you been to church yet?
Demanding,
you know, like, demanding. It was like, hey, we're heading to church today. Would you like to come? And I'm like, nah, I'm just gonna go home. And they're like, okay. And they will get to a crossroad, like I did. Like they will get to a crossroad, and they were like, you know what? Yeah, sure. You know, I was like, yeah, maybe I do need something. Or hey, Marcus, you always talk about this Jesus guy. Maybe,
but it sounds like the conversation, and I mean, what's interesting is that it wasn't going to church that brought you back to a relationship with Jesus. It was a conversation that you had with Josh, but also like the Holy Spirit working in you, like as a personal moment for you as well. So like when we're inviting people to church or inviting people to youth, it's not about getting them to youth so they can get saved already, or that the invite is almost just part one, or it's just the initial step, because it wasn't even like you went to church and then you're like, oh, that's right, I do love God. It was sort of like it was the message, it was the Holy Spirit working with you, it was all of that sort of stuff as well. So it's not even like
the invitation was like the tip of the iceberg.
To
everything. And then
so I would say in that it's also like conversations that we can have outside of church that might draw someone nearer to God.
And it came to relationships too, like it's really relational, you know. Everyone who was asking me, they really loved me and deeply cared, so that's why they were asking me. It's also relational. You know, it's hard when someone just random just comes up the street and is like, you need to go to church, and I'm like, oh, who are you, dude? I don't know you. But when it's your parents,
the dude with the megaphone on the street corner,
you need to come to church. But you know, when it's like, you know, I guess in the context of like, if you're with your friends, you know, like you we would love, as youth pastors, would love kids to come to youth, and we'll invite them on social media and stuff, but you can't be an invite face to face in your friends group from someone, you know, like together around I don't know what you do at the oval or whatever, and you just
on the handball court,
basketball court, you know, we can have the coolest like social media post for you to invite, but nothing will ever beat them standing in a circle and you just walk up to your friend and be like, hey dude, do you want to come to youth with me on Friday?
I think it's interesting, like hearing your testimony and like the background of you had that, and I know you kind of made amends, so I don't want to say it was a negative experience, but you had that bit of baggage, let's say, of them saying, I don't think you're cut out for this. I think that a lot of our, like, I know for my friends who were into Christianity and then stepped back, it's not a case of they just decided they hate God and that's the end of it. But there is baggage there. So I guess being able to be inviting and be welcoming, and also understanding that they're not saying no because they hate God or hate church or something, but because maybe they've gone through something or they've had some experience, be it with people or whatever, and that each person has their own story, their own experience,
and
being able to work towards that.
Yeah, asking someone's story helps them feel known, helps them know that you care. I think that's definitely hugely valuable and something that we can... Is it valuable or valuable? That's what I want to know. Because I just said valuable. Hugely valuable. When you ask someone for their story.
It's almost like we're talking about testimonies today. It's almost like everyone's got a testimony, just not everyone's finished it of meeting Jesus yet. So be willing to hear their story as much as anyone else's.
And they might have, like Lance, you've got a before Jesus, meeting Jesus, because Jesus, before Jesus, you know, like, you have that, those extra steps of like, you know, you were hurt or pushed away or distant. It's just gives the story more depth and just more glory to God. I feel like that, like you continued to work on you and walk with you, and you had these friends in your life.
And like, you know, obviously, like God had a whole plan through that whole thing. You know, like I could look back and just go, you know, there's probably many a time I could have just said whatever, that's it, I'm done. But that God actually had a greater plan and a purpose for me. Just
that I got to be a whole lot more interested in my non-Christian friends or stories. I think, kind of taken for granted. I should. Be as interested to hear their stories as I am to hear the testimonies of my Christian friends.
Dang, that's really good.
Yeah.
What have you taken away? Your final remarks. Away from your own story.
It's just like, I know it's kind of cliche, but it's like it was about others, because like from the other point of view, someone was really interested in me. Like they weren't just. Sometimes you sit with people and they just go, "Hey, how's it going?" And they go, "Oh, yeah. Oh, I had a terrible day today," and they go, "Oh, I had a worse day, mate."
Yeah, you know, me too. Yeah,
you know, it's the one up friend. They're always gonna kind of one up. But to someone like, you know, for us, it's like, oh, just be way more interested in them. So I think it's just a good life lesson for everyone. Just like, just be interested in other people and their stories, and when you talk in conversation, ask more about.
Yeah, you know, I love that. Like, that's what I've heard people say is like, when you actually sit down with someone, like if a conversation is boring, it's because you're boring. Like people are so interested, like interesting. Like if you sit down and actually take the time to pay attention and to listen to someone's story, they will blow you away with the stuff that they've experienced or learned or understand because of their life experience. Yeah. Like you just have no idea that sitting down and sharing stories with someone, the effect and the impact it can have. Like, yeah. It's incredible.
Because then you hear stories and then you get encouraged and you're like, oh my goodness, the amount of things you've gone through is nowhere near what I went through. But man, God was so faithful through it. And you've seen that the other side of that. So it just encourages you. And it's just good to know other people's story. And then like Jesus said, he just meets us where we're at. Mm-hmm. You know? So
totally.
Be interested in others. So.
Be interested in others. That's awesome. Yeah. Go ahead and this week, try and listen to someone's story, whether they're Christian, non-Christian, family, friend, whoever. Just try and take time out this week to try and... how many times can you say try and?
As many times as you want, mate.
As many times as you want. Take time this week to, listen to someone's story. Ask someone, hey, what's your story? What's your experience with church, if they have any, where they grew up. Just start somewhere and then let the conversation flow like you've seen today. You can send us your stories. If you've got the three-part to your testimony, you can... send it to us on Instagram. Yeah. Is that you typing it up? Look at him typing it up, just like that. Fantastic. Well, bless you. We love you. Have a great week. We will see you next week.
Ciao.
Ciao.